What's up? Welcome in. It's episode 46 of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. However you're listening or watching, we thank you for doing so, whether that's on Apple, Spotify, Google, Amazon, or if you're watching on the USA Baseball YouTube channel, we greatly appreciate it. All we ask is that you get us a rate and review or a like, give feedback however the medium you're using prefers that you do so. We would greatly appreciate it. And of course, follow USA Baseball on social media channels as well, at USA Baseball. They're on TikTok now. We are on TikTok now, I should say. I'm part of that. Find us on TikTok as well. New development for USA Baseball. So that's a lot of fun. For episode 46, we're doing sort of the opposite of getting on TikTok. That's a new school maneuver. We're kicking it a little old school with our guest on this edition of the program. You guys remember that Jim Abbott was a guest on this show not that long ago. This is a teammate of Abbott's on the 1988 gold medal winning Olympics team for Team USA in Seoul, Korea, Ted Wood, who's also an alum of the 18U national team program, the collegiate national team program, in addition to his experience in the summer games. Out of the University of New Orleans, he was a first-round draft pick, played in the majors, and actually didn't quite pan out in the major leagues. And he's very open about it, very honest about it. He went over to Asia and played in the Korean baseball organization, among other leagues over there, just to make a living for his family at that point when it hadn't worked out. Only a few years in the big leagues with the Expos and the Giants. And we'll talk about that in addition to his international experience. A lot of good stuff in this episode, number 46, with Ted Wood, formerly of Team USA. So let's get right into it. All right, Ted Wood, it's a pleasure to have you, and I hope you're doing well. You look well. So obviously that is in this weird year plus that everybody has had concern number one in any conversation I have. But Ted, I mean, you are a several-time alum of USA Baseball, won Olympic gold with the team in 1988 in the Seoul Olympics. So I'm excited to get into a lot of that. Let's start with the current. How is life for Ted Wood these days?
Well, first and foremost, thanks for having me on here. This is a great honor for me. So today, we've got two grandbabies. And a third one on the way in July. So the Wood family is expanding.
Nice.
We're pretty excited about that. I don't know if you have any grandchildren, but when the wife has a grandbaby, well, for me as well, but they get injected with a massive amount of energy. And Clara James was our first, and we've got Leonore Rose as our second. We don't know what the name is for the third baby that's due in July. So we're really, really excited.
Very good. Very good. All important things and exciting things for sure. Now, again, I mentioned gold medal with Team USA in 1988, but you joined the 18U program even before that, 1985. Was that, correct me if I'm wrong, that was your first experience with the organization?
Correct. Yeah.
What do you remember about sort of just getting involved with USA Baseball? Obviously a passionate and great player in your youth up to that point. Was it something that had been on your radar, or did it come sort of out of nowhere?
I think it kind of showed up out of nowhere. At the time, they had what they called the National Sports Festival. And so they would grab what they felt was the best players from North, South, East, and West. And we all went to Alex Box Stadium at LSU and kind of grinded it out against each other in that format. And then they pulled, I want to say, about 20 players from that format to go to Albany, New York to play in the World Championships. So that was the first, contact with USA Baseball growing up. So that was a kind of a big event. And then to make the team, just a little Ohio kid, going down in Louisiana, I've never sweated as much as I did stretching that first or second time at Alex Box Stadium. There was stuff coming off my nose and it just never stopped. It was just, we would stretch and it was just like a faucet. And, you know, and then I went to school in New Orleans, so I kind of got used to it. But at the end of the day, I had never been exposed to that.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. An area you got familiar playing in. There must have been something that made you want to go back, which we can get into your time at New Orleans here in a bit. Was it a bit daunting at that age, showing up at the Box and playing with presumably other stars as you were at that level?
I think when you're young, sometimes you don't realize where you are and you kind of go with what you know, so to speak. I do remember going down to the bullpen pregame, and there was this guy that was like 6'5", and his name was Smoltz, and I was on the North team, and he was from Michigan, and I went down there and I saw that act in the bullpen prior to our first game, and I said, "Whoa." I remember walking back in the dugout. I'm not sure I could play on this level. Just go with what you know. And if it's not good enough, well, as we found out, there was another couple of good pitchers, but there was really nobody like that guy. And Smoltz was an amazing, and he made the team and all that. But it was when I went down to that bullpen and I saw that act, I was like, man, this is a different level for me.
Did you maybe get another example of that at other points in your career? Because I think at 18 years old, obviously, you know, now in hindsight, okay, he's the only Hall of Famer here. It probably, like you said, it because you were watching him, you were like, okay, does everybody play this way? Did anybody else do that for you on your way up, whether you saw them in college or you know, early
in pro ball, I went down in Phoenix once, and there was a guy named Jimmy Williams, and he was left-hander, and he was like 6'6", and boy, did he have some stuff. So I went, you know, and occasionally I was like, man, how do these guys hit this guy? And I just was so glad that he was on my team. Yeah, there's some guys that can really, really get after it on the mound.
So you show up at the Box for that trials period. And then you make the 18U national team in 1985 with the likes of John Smoltz and other greats on that team. Was there any point at which you sort of looked around and it became this epiphany, I belong moment, especially given your experience observing Smoltzy?
Not really. I grew up a coach's kid.
Yeah.
And one of the mottos my dad always would preach to me was, no matter how good you are, there always will be somebody that's probably a little bit better. So there was always that, okay, you know, you've arrived, but you're not, there will be somebody better. And you're always kind of seeking out that person again. And there was not any, look, I'm here ever. Playing in the world format against other countries, so yeah. Every day was a little bit different. So it was just such a pleasure. You know, I'll use the term armor. You know, you develop a little bit of more armor to kind of go up against the next gladiator, so to speak.
Yeah,
and you know, I thank the Lord I didn't have to face Smoltz because he was on my team, but. Yeah, there's such a great amount of talent in our country, and then you go to the world, and there's just another whole brand of talent all over the world.
Do you remember facing Smoltz like in a practice setting or an intra-squad setting? What that was like?
I faced John in Fulton County once.
Okay,
and you know. I think I popped up to left field, so I was pretty happy that I actually made contact. yeah, that was about the only time I ever faced him in a game setting.
Yeah. What about in the bigs? Did you guys not cross paths?
That was the one time we crossed paths. And
yeah,
I got a September call up. I want to say that was in 91 and we were in Atlanta. Maybe it might've been 92, but anyways, I faced him pinch hit or something late in the game and, you know, popped up the left and
yeah. Okay.
So it was, you know, I was like, whew, he didn't strike me out.
If you would go back and recall the moment that you realized you had made that 18U national team. And again, as you mentioned, when you're younger, there are certain things that don't just set in. So maybe this didn't occur until you were a collegian with Team USA. But was there a moment of I don't know, is it euphoria, pride? You know, you throw on a jersey and all of the sudden you've got USA across your chest.
Yeah, it was more of a surprise. I remember we were in the dorms on the campus of LSU near the ballpark there, and they had the list up and my name was on it. And I was like, oh boy, I actually made this team, because I didn't know where I was on the scale. And I had made the team. And Dave Silvestri was my roommate. I think he was like an alternate or something. They put up like a check mark, which was kind of tough because he ended up being the shortstop on the Olympic team that we, you know, eventually played on. So we had started our relationship in that National Sports Festival, but I made the team. And, you know, this was not a cell phone period. This was kind of like who can get the phone. And I want to say we might have even used, you know, MCI cards or, you know, coins or whatever to get call the house and say, hey, I think I'm going to New York, you know, for the world championship. So that was I guess the euphoria may have come a little bit after the surprise. Mm-hmm. I'll be brutally honest.
You get some time, you get up there, you travel, you get suited up for the first game. Maybe that's when it sets in. You're just like, yeah, okay, I mean, when
you're playing for the North, right? And then you have, you're playing for the United States now, right? And you got the jacket and you got the shirt and the pants. And, you know, it's like Christmas for young kids when they get all the equipment that you get when you play for the national team. So it was a big, big, cool event once we got up there, and then we've got to play against other teams, right? The euphoria lasts about 30 minutes and then you've got somebody in front of you that wants to beat you. And that was my beginning with international baseball, so to speak.
When you mentioned just being a kid from Ohio, I can't imagine you had a lot of exposure to, you know, playing guys from Cuba or other countries in that way. So something I'm always interested, even today, Ted, and in recent years, the past handful of years, I always ask, you know, what are your impressions of international baseball from a team to team aspect? So like our collegiate national team these days in recent years will host Japan for a series. They'll host Cuba for a series, Chinese Taipei for a series. And it's all this different brand of baseball. But the cool thing to me is it's still baseball. It's a universal language. There are just different dialects, right? What do you recall about your impressions of stylistically the baseball from country to country?
Yeah, it's interesting because you've got like everybody always wants to talk about the Cubans. So let's start with them. I mean, they've got, you know, they're playing instruments, so to speak, sometimes in the dugout. So that was the first time I was exposed to kind of that banter. And, you know, I'll always say the Cubans taught me how to slow the game down when you're not in the lead. So when you're trying to make a comeback, they would play this slow roll game. You know, they weren't swinging at first pitches. They would really, really make you work.
Yeah.
And then they would kind of take time and then they would kind of forcing you to kind of realize that you were in the moment, like you almost could beat them if you did this thing right. Right. But the longer you're in the movie, so to speak, they felt like they had an advantage, and that was, they were very effective at that. the Asian countries. There was kind of fans with, you know, horns or noisemakers. That was the first time I was exposed to that. It was almost like a soccer environment or a kind of a football environment.
Yeah.
In a baseball setting. And I'd never seen anything like that before. And it was really neat to kind of start getting exposed to that. And, you know, other Latin countries, you know, Latin players throughout my whole career have always been players that I would like to play with, because there's one thing about Latin players is the aggressiveness that they play the game with. And it's cool to watch. And regardless of what Latin country, it seems like they are all in for baseball. And that's pretty neat. But yeah, we had a lot of different flavors on that. You know, we, and 18 years old, you're just trying to, you know, does this guy, what kind of pitches does he have? Here comes the Asian guys that throw from under, you know, sidearm submarine, left-handed, right-handed, you know, 3-0 sliders, all those different, you know, styles of tactics that can kind of wear a player down mentally. And we had to kind of grind through all that.
More with Ted Wood here in just a second, but a special announcement. The 2021 Armed Forces On-Field 5950 cap is here at usabaseballshop.com. You can support our heroes by donning this camo military-style USA Baseball cap, and USA Baseball will proudly donate all of the net proceeds from the sale of Armed Forces products to support and recognize service members, veterans, and military families. Again, it's the 2021 Armed Forces On-Field 5950 from New Era. Limited supplies available, but you also need to gear up for the summer. So check out some of the other stuff there at usabaseballshop.com. Remember, free ground shipping on all orders of $99 or more. Make an order that includes the 2021 Armed Forces On-Field 5950 from New Era, and support our heroes at USA Baseball Shop today. So you get through the 18U experience, and as we mentioned earlier, you end up at the University of New Orleans.
Correct.
Walk me through that process. I think, you know, it's going to be a vastly different process in the mid to late 80s than say now, because we do have a lot of younger players who listen and watch the show. Walk me through the recruitment process, the process of you finding your fit as a college player.
Yeah, so that process back then was not nearly as, I wouldn't even use the word easy, because it's really not easy today, right? But the reality is you have a lot of venues where you can show yourself out. Back then they had, you know, a Connie Mack tournament here or there, or a coach would recommend somebody that maybe went to the same high school that they had another player from, right? So John Groth had played at the University of New Orleans and had left a junior college, I want to say, up in Ohio, and that coach recommended me to the University of New Orleans. So we had a little bit of a link there. We went down and we recruited Mississippi State. I showed up at Ron Polk's office once, and with my father, and the University of New Orleans was supposed to play them, but I was interested in playing anywhere where it was warm.
Sure.
That was really the checkpoint, right? Get me out of the cold so I can do my thing and go to the office more often, so to speak. So we went to Coach Polk's office, and, you know, it was, you know, Mississippi State had whatever players that they had at the time. And so, you know, he gave me the, you know, we've got a lot of openings, but not enough for everybody. And then the funny part about that whole experience was, at Alex Box Stadium at the North, South, East, and West, the National Sports Festival, Coach Polk was there with my future coach, Coach Schwanner, and he gave me that look like, you see, every once in a while you miss, you know, that one guy. And yeah, so I had fun grinding against him for 3 years at University of New Orleans. But yeah, we made the decision to go to UNO, and UNO had just come off going to the World Series, the College World Series in 84, I believe. Coach Maestri, who is, you know, one of the premier coaches of the country, had decided he was going to be an athletic director only. And Coach Tom Schwanner was my head coach at the time. So his first year was my first year at the University of New Orleans.
Yeah.
So that freshman season was, you know, going in, was I going to play? Nothing was guaranteed, right? And so you just have to kind of grind through all that.
Yeah. How much did you find you, and you mentioned having a coach for a dad, how much did you guys find yourselves recruiting yourself, like the trip to Mississippi State? Or was it, you know, I've got UNO as a sort of an option, and, you know, if we pass by a Ron Polk's office on the way to that, then sure. Were you guys a little more active than even just that?
We were as active as we could be at the time. Bowling Green was interested in Ohio. Indiana was interested in Ohio. I went and had a visit there. Ohio State became interested really late after I had signed with University of New Orleans. So, but it wasn't, you know, it wasn't like I had 50 offers. I had, you know, like a half of offer here, you know, a small offer here. And quite frankly, I wanted to go to where it was warm. So I was seeking something. And, you know, I landed at the University of New Orleans, and he came up and saw, Coach Schwanner came up and saw me pitch at a high school game. And I almost threw a no hitter, didn't play the outfield. Didn't swing the bat very well, and I wasn't going there to pitch, right? I was going there to play outfield. So, but I do remember him saying that I hit a pop up that dropped, and I was at third base. So at least he can run, right? So, yeah, that was, the recruiting process was nowhere near like it is today, and I'm not sure it's worse today or better today, because I think there's times when coaches back in those days would do probably more homework on the individual as opposed to, you know, getting to a perfect game event or one of these recruiting systems. You know, they just don't have the travel budget, I don't believe.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and from a player perspective, I mean, there are obviously more opportunities to be seen than ever, even in that. You know, Ted, there are prospects that get discovered that take video of themselves working out, and they post it to social media. So I think you're right in that there are certainly pros in the way that it's done now, perhaps that outweigh the cons.
No question. You have more access.
Yeah. So then at UNO, obviously you have success there. For what is a good program, and you mentioned it coming off of the College World Series there. I don't think you know, probably younger viewers and listeners would quite know UNO as the baseball power that it is and has been. So it's not even like that was a safety net for you when we say things like, okay, you had UNO in the bag before seeking out these other things. So you have some success. You've got the 18U experience with us at USA Baseball under your belt. And I like the way you mentioned it earlier. You referred to it as armor. You've got that armor. It's a little bit tougher to break your confidence at that mm-hmm. point, yeah, right? Yeah. After the 18U experience, maybe immediately after and pre-UNO, I don't know how much baseball would have been in between those two. But in the immediate aftermath, what was that armor like? I mean, it had to feel pretty thick, right?
Yeah, I mean, playing against the world, so to speak, yeah. I certainly had an experience that I could say, okay, well, I can handle this. Let's see what I can handle here. And that time frame from that period to when I went to the University of New Orleans was probably like 3 weeks.
Yeah.
So August-ish was the national team tournament in New York. And then fall ball used to be like 45 games, in all the really the better weathered areas of the South. So you would have 40, 45 games, coming into the fall. So you're coming right out of to that mix to right into that fall season. And you're trying to make your name to try to get, scratch your way in to get somebody to notice you that you can play and you might be an option for them. So that was kind of another stair step. There wasn't a whole lot of time to celebrate, and you're right into to the fall season. And, we're playing Tulane. Mm-hmm. We're playing, there was a junior college kind of a recruiting tool that they would use. We'd go play junior colleges. Maybe you get to play your younger players and also get to see the JUCO's younger player or the players that are going to graduate into the system, so to speak. So that was a big thing in Florida that we'd go to in the fall. So we had a nice little kind of fall trip. But baseball seems to breed people that don't celebrate a whole lot because the next day could be an 0-for-4 with 4 punch outs. And we all know that those show up every so often. So not a whole lot of celebration there.
This segueing into your selection to the collegiate national team. Mm-hmm. For USA Baseball. And again, the armor comes in handy here, I'm sure, right? There's another trials process. There's another set of circumstances that go into being named to that team. And coming out of UNO, what was that like? Did you find it, sort of easier? You had made the connection and now you were playing well. How did it go from there?
So as a freshman, I was on the freshman All-American team. So that was a cool event. I went to that summer, I went to the Illinois Collegiate League. So that was my freshman summer. And then my sophomore year, we played Miami, I think, 5 to 6 times. Hmm. We played a series down there. We played a series on ESPN, which was kind of the cool event back then. College baseball, you get that Sunday night game that everybody was all into. So that was great. And then we played them in the Superdome. They started this series between like Florida and Louisiana. So we had a nice little rivalry going there. But I got into play in front of Coach Frazier, and I did so well during those games. I think I got 5 hits in one of the games. I got, a couple of hits and a home run at Alex or Mark Light Stadium. Yeah. In Miami. And that probably helped me a bunch to kind of show off what I could do, not knowing that he was going to be the Pan American Games coach. You're just out there playing ball, taking on whatever was in front of you. But that was a really, really a good blessing for me to play in front of Coach Frazier and do so well.
So from that point on, was that one pretty much just a call from him?
I had gotten called up to the little office above the field, and we had already signed. I think I had signed up to go to Alaska for the summer, so I had made the commitment at the time. And then I got brought up to the box up above our benches, and they said you are asked to go try out for the United States team. And I was like, whoa, this is the college national team that we're all reading about in Baseball America. Right. And that's back then, that was like the link. There was no website. There was Baseball America that would come out once every, 2 weeks or 1 month at a time. So I knew that was a big, cool opportunity for me. And then my teammate, Joe Sluzarski, the right-handed pitcher that had come down from a JUCO in Illinois, from University of New Orleans, was asked as well. And then our first baseman, Brian Traxler, was asked to come and try out for that team. He actually didn't get to make it, but we all went as teammates. So it was really neat to have three players going and try out for this college national team.
What do you remember about, I don't know if you guys traveled together for that or what, were they picking your brain knowing that you had been involved with the 18U process?
Not really, because that to me was a totally different connection to USA Baseball at the time. Everybody knew about the college national team. The high school national team, I don't think was as publicized at the time. But yeah, it was, you know, to go to Millington, Tennessee, which is where they would train and have to stay at the Navy or the military barracks there. We all kind of learned that, you know, this is how you do it. And this is what we did back in those days. And it was really, really a great facility and a great town.
Did you have any concern at all that you wouldn't make the collegiate national team?
Oh, for sure. I mean, when you're going in those environments, you could have a bad week. You could have a bad day. And you could be shown the door pretty quickly because of all the great players that showed up that year. So, I mean, there was never any entitlement at all. It was you know, one of the questions when I was up above at our University of New Orleans in the box was, well, does this mean I'm on the team or do I have to tell Alaska no and I'm going to lose Alaska? So, yeah, I mean, the selfishness of the individual at some point says, well, what happens if I don't make it?
Right.
Right. But, you know, being in those environments, if you start to get a little bit into that, I don't think you have a chance. You just have to play. And if it's not the right period or it's not the right time for you, then you just have to, you know, be shown the door. But at the end of the day, you know, knowing Coach Frazier and knowing what we had done in the past, I think we were set up pretty well.
So that ultimately led to multiple stints with the national team there, including the 1988 Olympics.
Correct.
Now, you talk about the levels of high school national team, collegiate national team. Oh man, now I'm going to the Olympics.
Right.
Did that just seem like the intensity was ratcheted up for that third time around?
For sure. And then the light bulb kind of went off when we went back in 88. So you had the Mike Fioris, mm-hmm. you had the Dave Silvestris, you had the Ed Sprague, you had Jim Abbott, you had Ty Griffin, you had Tino Martinez. So then we got there and it was like, oh, so they were thinking last year that we were going to kind of graduate into this Olympic year and we were just playing ball and we weren't thinking, or at least I wasn't. Oh,
right.
Gosh, I'm going to parlay this into an Olympic year, right? We all knew that the Olympics would. We get back and you've got a totally different environment. Coach Frazier's environment was a lot different than Coach Marcus. Different styles. Different parts of the country, different players. But there was a business first mentality and we knew what we were going to do. We knew what our goal was. There was a quiet, thought process. We going back to back to Millington, we're at the military barracks. I think we brought eight or nine guys from the 87 team. And then, you know, a whole slew of other guys. Andy Bennis now is there. Ben McDonald's there.
Yeah.
On top of our other parts of our team. Now we've got Robin Ventura, you know, coming off a 56, you know, the hitting streak.
The hit streak, yeah.
Oh, boy. You know, what an incredible teammate he was. But all these, you know, new guys, but not really new. We kind of knew who they were and we knew all the stars and and all things that they had did at their university. So now we've got this team, and Coach Marcus from Stanford, you know, we were going to grind our way to do as best as we could.
You had, like, you've done a great job listing the names here. You know, Jim Abbott, who's been a guest on the show, and Ben McDonald, Golden Spikes Awards winners. Andy Bennis ended up being the number one pick. I see, I'm looking at the roster now. Tom Goodwin, you may or may not have mentioned.
Wow. Yeah.
you mentioned Joe Solarski. Ed Sprague was a first rounder. Robin Ventura, obviously.
Mike Milchen.
Yeah. Yep. And let's see. Scott Service.
Brett Barbary.
Coach now. Yep. Barbary is on this team as well.
Mickey Morandini.
Yeah.
I mean, we had players. So we had as good as we could have when you just had, you know, 21-year-old kind of kids, college player at the time.
At that point in your life, was that the most talent you had been around? Like the greatest collection of it?
It was no question. That was actually probably a more stressful event in 88. I didn't play against Stanford, right? I didn't go 5 for 6 like I did at Miami the year before. So now I've got a coach, and maybe I am 6 days away from getting shown the door, so to speak, right? Because, you know, he's got to do the best he can to field the best team that's, you know, got the guys that are playing well. I kind of got off to a slower start in 88 during the season. My college season. Mm-hmm. So we had plenty of players, you know, and it was, you're facing Andy Bennis throwing a gazillion, right? Jim Abbott, you know, at the time, I've never seen a left-handed pitcher throw like that. I had had to face him at Texas in the regional when he was with Michigan.
Yeah.
And that was like, whoa, this is different, right? You know, I've faced left-hand pitchers, but this guy is different. So, I mean, that was the hardest I'd ever seen any left-hander throw. And so he was a handful to deal with. And a competitor too, right? That, oh, shucks, little thing he's got going on. He is not giving in, that guy. I mean, as you saw later in the summer, he's going to be standing there at the end. And he's going to be giving you his best swipe. So, there was a quiet confidence with that team. There was an internal expectation with that team that there wasn't really too many things that distracted us. We had fun. You know, we weren't, you know, always angels probably, but at the end of the day, when the lights were on, there was an expectation level that you brought what you brought, and it was a blast to play for.
What was it like? And by this point, you had been thrown into a few of these situations where it's always interesting to me seeing the collegiate national team guys come in, and you know, now we're based in North Carolina, so they'll come to the national training complex and carry and train and work out, and they get a couple of weeks before they start the international series that they play in a typical year. And you just see this meshing, and it comes together so quickly, Ted, right? There are the cliques, you know, the SEC guys will pal around because they see more of each other and probably have played against each other in the circuits prior to their college days, because a lot of them are from the same areas and things like that. But then, you know, you get the West Coast guys, and I'm reminded of that with Coach Mark Marcus here coming from Stanford and bringing his own flavor. And Ventura is not a West Coast guy, but out West, somebody you saw less of. What was the mixing of personalities like when you guys initially got together?
So we used to have this bus that would pick us up in Millington. And one of the guys that was one of the new guys, nicknamed us, I think we had 8 or 9 guys, the Pan Am Boys. So it was kind of a little bit of a dig, right? Yeah. You know, hey, there's the Pan Am boys. And so, you know, blah, 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 whatever. And we knew what we were doing because we were there last year and all that. But at the end of the day, you know, when you're grinding against the likes of Cuba, when you're having to go against areas, you know, there's no way that you can win a game unless you're 100% committed as a team. And, you know, Ron Ventura may have been, I played him a short period on the field. I've seen him play forever. But as far as a teammate, whew, it's hard to imagine a better teammate than Robin Ventura. So he was not on the 87 team, right? And he came with, you know, the 12 or 13 new guys. So there was a little bit of a link there, and he was like not interested in any kind of separation. It just wasn't his style, right? But at the end of the day, we're playing ball. Everybody wants to play. Not everybody can play. And there's times when you're on these teams, you're going to sit a little bit. And it's not fun to sit, but at the end of the day, it's what these national teams. But when you're thinking like, okay, we're going to try to win a gold medal, then, you know, a lot of the individual stuff goes away. And who's our best chance to win this game? Coach Marcus, ooh, what a great competitor. He brought a flavor offensively, two-strike approach that was, you know, nothing I had ever seen before. And just the expectation that you grinded with two strikes was kind of his motto. And he would tell everybody, you're the best with two, right? And that was his little banter from the dugout, right? But it was, although, you know, we would maybe kid around about it occasionally. When you're up there and you hear that, you know, from your coach, that's a pretty big thing to have. And, you know, we were grinders. We were grinders, a bunch of grinders on that team offensively.
Yeah, I want to go back to Robin Ventura. Mm-hmm. Mainly because I think he's probably got more of a reputation as sort of a prickly guy, personality wise. And I don't know exactly where that comes from. Maybe it's the, you know, the fight that everyone's seen with Nolan Ryan or something like that. But what was it about him that just made him a better teammate, obvious to that standard for you guys in 88?
Just the performer that he was, the way he would go through his at-bats. I hit behind him. I think it was Robin and then Tino, and then I hit fifth. So we didn't do the whole righty-lefty thing. We kind of had three of us right together there. And just watching him grind at-bats and the body language and how he would slow down and but a kind of a no nonsense guy with a little bit of humor as a teammate, but never a back down guy ever. He looked almost like he was in slow motion sometimes. Like he was like, oh, well, I got this figured out. Never, when you're with him, never did you feel like he was just, what I call cool breezing, right?
Yeah.
He was grinding. It's just his body language was like in slow, like, you know, they always say the good hitters slow down. Mm-hmm. He looked like that's what he was doing while he was grinding. And that, I mean, that's a hard, you know, it's controlled violence when you hit, right? You're violently firing this bat at this 100 mile an hour ball, but you have to have this kind of this soft control, you know, easiness, or you're going to swing at everything and strike out. So what a incredible bat handler. Just could do anything he wanted with a bat. And you know, nobody talks about his defense, but I don't remember him missing a ball ever. I mean, at third base I don't remember him making an error that whole summer. And we all made our errors, right? But I don't remember one. It was certainly not in the big part of the game. Mm-hmm. So what a great all around person. but talent. And, you know, somebody I looked to try to emulate because I knew what how much of a great player he was.
Yeah. And of course, now, you know, a coach at his alma mater, that type of poise that you're talking about, something that surely I makes for a good coach, I would have to imagine, right? Especially you're not the one exacting this controlled violence, whereas you're sort of the more indirect control of it when you're translating it to players too.
Well, and I think body language and you know, baseball's always talk about don't get too high, too low, right? Well, there's times when you have to be a little bit mentally high, so to speak. You've got to, you know, this at bat means something to the game. And so I've occasionally had travel teams that I'll go help, and I don't want to coach third base. I don't want to coach first base. I want to be in the dugout and trying to impose, hey, this is going to happen. And so be prepared for this situation. And when you can prepare kids like that, then they start coming to you with, hey, coach, I kind of see like this guy's, he's creating the inning for us, right? So we don't want to be in a hurry right here. Now there's another guy that might be filling up the strike zone, like, okay, well, we can't be 0-2 every time either, right? So it's kind of a nice, it's an interesting balance when you kind of get a feel of the flow of the game. And I think Robin's, there's nobody better at knowing that than he.
Yeah. So getting to those Olympic games, you guys took out host Korea, obviously Puerto Rico and Japan to win the gold medal. You yourself hit .474 and set the record for a batting average for the USA in Olympic competition. Although your teammate Tino Martinez was only 3 points behind you in batting average with .471. The added international travel element, I don't know to what degree any of you had traveled internationally at that time, but being in Korea, having to play against Korea, again, the intensity was there. We've mentioned it. The magnitude of play is just simply because it's the Olympics. What do you remember about, was there hostility because you were in Korea, facing Korea, trying to knock them off on your way?
Quite frankly, we were kind of worn out at the time. So we had gone from Italy and then we went back to Japan for like a kind of a university series as kind of a bridge to the Olympics because we didn't want to come all the way back home.
Right.
So we played the world championships in Italy for, I think we were there like 18 days or something. So we were out of the country, I think as high, maybe it was like 5 or 6 weeks. So we were kind of worn out with being out of the country kind of thing. Mm-hmm. I had pulled my hamstring in Japan. And so, you know, me and the trainer would have to go to the track when we first got to Seoul every day to do rehab so that I could actually stay on the field.
Yeah.
But you know, the maximum we could have played would have been 5 games at that point. So it wasn't like, oh, well, we can't play. We're so tired. We can't play 5 games. No. We know what we're doing.
Yeah.
But we had lost to Cuba in a really tough deal in the world championships. And Cuba didn't go to the Olympics.
Right. They boycotted, right?
We wanted to make a statement. And after grinding against them for 2 years, we had gone to Havana in 87. Abbott wins against the Cubans in Havana.
Yep.
That was an event.
Yeah. Which quick reverse plug. When he was on this show, he described the game and the moment. It's unreal.
I don't know what that's, I think Estadio Latin America, whatever that stadium is, right in Havana. When they open that door and their players come through that tunnel and they do this unison clap thing, it was like the gladiator. We were like it was the gladiators. I mean, it was like, oh my gosh, we're going to get killed here. And to watch him pitch that day was phenomenal. But yeah, so we went to the Olympics with a little bit of a jab in the ribs because we had had the Cubans beat late. Jim was pitching, actually, I think, at the time, and we had him in the eighth or ninth inning. I think we were up 3-1, and we lost 4-3. And there was a weird call at first base, and it looked like the guy was out. We would have had one or two outs in the ninth with a two-run lead. And like I've said before, the Cubans, once they sense or you make one little mishap, it was like, uh-oh. And that's ended up what happened. And they beat us late. And that really hurt because they weren't coming to the Olympics. We knew that.
Yeah.
So we were like, okay, we win the Olympics, but this is the real team that everybody knows they're really good. Right. And so we wanted to have our little stamp of approval, but it didn't work out that way. But so we got the Olympics, and it was, the first couple of games, there's an extra buzz to them, right? It was just being in the village, you could tell that there was a little bit more emphasis on everything that we did. And, going to the food line and seeing the type of fruit that they have at these events, these Olympic events, is like ridiculous. It's fantastic. And we're just like college kids looking for, hey, you guys got any fried chicken, and they've got rice and all the healthy stuff. And we're looking for ice cream or something. Right. Watching those athletes, prior to us playing was amazing.
Yeah. Was there any sport that you guys, I mean, obviously your tunnel vision and honed in on your own goals. Did you find yourself peeking at other events and getting particularly into one that maybe you didn't expect to?
We went to a boxing match once. Well, where we lived in our little dorm area, the boxers were there. So yeah. We had seen Riddick Bowe, and he would be shadow boxing in the little thing underneath our condo there. And he was comical. I think he said something to the effect of, I'm going to hit him with the left cross. I'm going to hit him with the right cross. I'm going to send him to the red cross or something. he was a treat to be around. And that was the year that John Thompson was coaching the basketball team, and they ended up not doing so well. And I think that started the impetus for the dream team. So we were very into that. I think we went to a gymnastics event, but there really wasn't a ton of time because we would have our little practice. You'd have to go through the little security line, then you would have to eat, and then you'd have to kind of, line up tickets. And, it wasn't like oh, you just got all this time. We were watching more TV than anything, probably.
Yeah. Winning gold. Just take me to that moment, because at that point, again, you had done it in the scale of international play, but come on, man, this is the Olympics and you guys pulled it off. Like, I can't imagine the feeling, right? I mean, Ted, you're in the total number of people that win gold medals at the Olympics grows with every 4 years, I guess. But I mean, it's such a small percentage of people that walk the earth that get to do that.
Yeah, it was, that day was, it's interesting. I look back and it just felt like it was brighter. The intensity of the sun was higher, like there was extra lights on or something. And there was this quiet confidence, a little nervous tick, but never were we intimidated. But let's face it, the Japanese were really, really good. And I think Tino hit a couple home runs late to give us a lead. And that place was not like, oh, well, you just hit a fly ball and it goes out. It was like a graveyard in center field. And Tino hits home run. And it was like, oh, boy, that's a game changer. And then I think we scratched and clawed and we ended up winning it. But being able to go, well, when you hear our national anthem after the event, right, and you won the gold medal and you're chiming it up with the boys and jumping on top of each other and doing all that. After 6 weeks out of the country, after a year before losing to the Cubans in the Pan American game and getting the silver over there, and you know, it all coming together was awesome because it's a gold medal, right? Everybody wants that, but the team was like this unit, and being up on that stage when they play that national anthem and you're outside of your country in a different environment and you're winning a gold medal is fantastic. It's just not, there's nothing that you can say that would even come close to comparing to that.
Where's the gold medal now? Where do you have it?
Sitting right over there. Medal case. You know, I've got grandbabies now, and my daughter's, you know, my Nadia's 30 now, and Dior's 27. So growing up, every 4 years in elementary school, that medal would go to wherever their classes were, and you know, letting people get a little taste of what it's like to have one in their hand.
That's cool. Very cool. With that in mind, I mean, obviously we had, because of COVID, the Tokyo games were pushed back from 2020. We're set to have baseball back in the Olympics in 2021. Now the U.S. still needs to qualify, which is another conversation for another day. But Ted, I mean, you got to be excited to see it back in the lexicon, right?
Yeah. I mean, baseball not being in the Olympics just doesn't sound right. Haven't been through the, you know, how these other countries view baseball is, they view it, maybe it's their one passionate sport for their country, right? I mean, in Asia, there are a lot of baseballs, maybe their number one sport. So it's cool to see it back. Look, the international game's a different game, right? So, it takes a special kind of player to be able to travel the world, have an umpire make a bad call occasionally, and not lose your mind, right? It's there's a lot of, and look, let's face it, the United States, generally everybody wants to take down the big dog, so to speak, and whether it be Cuba or the United States or whoever, I mean, we tend to lead in the professional ranks in baseball. So you're going up against that team's best, whatever they have that day, every single day. So it's cool that they're going to have that back in the Olympics and this year. And hopefully we'll get over there and be able to compete.
No doubt. You just reminded me of a comment Skip Schumacher made to me one time about playing in Cuba. And the way he put it was, you know, he was on a team full of guys bound for the big leagues, and because of political circumstances, they were facing a team full of guys who were plenty capable and wanted that, right? So it was to Skip, he's like, look, like we've all got our careers, the part of it that's making us money back stateside, so we show up, and it's not that we don't want it, there's just no possible way we could have wanted it more than these guys, because they were like rabid dogs trying to get at us and prove a point and show up. And, you know, at that point, it's a big stage. And the more, for instance, we stream games when Cuban national teams come to the States now, we stream those games, and it's an opportunity to impress for them. So yeah, I love it. I love the international game, just in the little glimpses that we get here in North Carolina hosting the teams against the collegians and that sort of thing. So I'm glad to see it back.
At the time, Omar Linares was like, you know, Usain Bolt and Barry Bonds mixed together, plays third base. I mean, he was that type of player. And then you've got Kindlin and Victor Mesa and these guys. I mean, they're professional players. But what a zeal for the game of baseball. They love the game.
Yeah, exactly.
So cool.
A couple more things for you, Ted. Yeah. Then you get drafted first round. Again, I made I put it in this perspective for the Olympic gold medal. I wouldn't expect this to really match up with it, but you're one of a very small percentage of people to get drafted that high. You were 29th overall in the MLB draft. And cooler now because you had this experience, I'm sure, of you had teammates, guys that you had gone and gotten gold medal with. They also got taken in that first round. So it's this cool, you talk about the unit. It's just, it adds to the story of the unit that you guys get to share in this experience. And Andy Bennis goes one overall, and several others from that team get taken. I will say, back then, it was not, now this year's MLB draft, for instance, will be on TV and they'll have live feeds into people's living rooms where they're celebrating with their families when they get picked. That was not the case back then necessarily. What was draft day like for you?
It's interesting. It certainly wasn't like it is today with the media. There was almost like a squawk box call that would come across somehow, and they would call. I was notified via my college coach, and my parents had come down to New Orleans from Ohio to be there for this draft, just in case, we had to make any decisions or anything like that. I remember, being pulled into the office with my coach Schwanner and letting us know that we had, gotten taken in X pick, and you're kind of sitting there like, wow, this is cool. I'm transitioning to the professional game right now, which is what we all wanted to do growing. Everybody wants to play professional baseball. So it was this transition. But at that time, that was in June, right? The Olympics wasn't until October-ish for the.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, my chronology's mixed up. So we're
drafted. Okay, great. Celebrate. And then they had, we weren't allowed to get our money at a certain pacers because it was for the amateur player, or the Olympics was all amateur at the time.
Yeah.
We had to defer our money and settle that situation, but you're on the way to go play for the United States at the time. So it wasn't, like, okay, flip that switch and then we just go right to pro ball. I went to the instructional league with the Giants in 80, right after the Olympics, about 3 or 4 weeks after.
Yeah.
And played in the instructional league for a bit and then started my first season the next year in Shreveport.
That's that's a wild mix. I had, because of the amateur status and right. The nature of the Olympics, yeah. I had gotten it mixed up. But yeah, no, back then it would have been you defer your money and you remain an amateur for the length that it requires for you to participate in the Olympics and that sort of thing. And I keep going back to the armor, Ted. That added to the armor, right? I mean, you were 29th overall pick. You're playing with the number one overall pick on the bump. Like, That just adds to the armor when you get to Korea.
Yeah, look, you go and play. You're the number one pick of X team, and oh wait, we got 9 of them or whatever it was, or 10 or 12. Yeah. Oh wait, you think you're good? Well, there's the second pick, and there's the first. So is your armor only so thick at that point when we got all those guys with you? But at the end of the day, professional ball is a completely different animal. Mm-hmm. But having to, grind on that level certainly gives you the confidence to go in a professional setting and try to, show your stripes on that front.
What is the fondest memory from your professional career? And I'm leaving this open-ended because maybe you've got a wacky story about, the less than ideal conditions of traveling with the minor league team or something that maybe is more of like a welcome to the big leagues moment for you. So I'm leaving it broad so that you can take your pick there.
Hey, look, I have one home run in the major leagues, right? It was in San Diego, and I had broken my finger. somebody got hit by Eric Hellman and was on the DL. And they kind of said, if you wanted to, you know, call it a year, you could, because there's only X amount of days left. I said, no, I don't think I'm going to do that. So I hung around and went on the trip and got healthy. And they said, hey, go hit. And I was hitting off a guy that had owned me in the minor leagues, Tim Scott. And I got into a good count. And I kind of knew what he was going to do. And I was kind of there before he was there. So I hit one pretty well and it went out. And that was probably my career best, so to speak. Let's face it, I didn't play very long in the major league. So it wasn't like there was a ton of things to talk about. But at the end of the day, that was a big event for me personally.
Yeah. And Ted, I've read and, you know, and heard interviews with you before. You're obviously very open about it not panning out, right? And you're not sticking necessarily in the bigs in some of the ways that your collegiate national team teammates did, or others that were drafted as highly. When you look back on it, how do you process it? The idea that didn't happen. You mentioned, you know, an injury here or there, and quite frankly, I mean, you know, there are so many variables that factor in for anybody. So no matter how good a player someone is, it's things have to go right. So I'm just curious, from your perspective, looking back all these years later, how do you process it?
Look, baseball, I would say 95% of the time is right. Right. So there may be that 5% of the time that somebody got lucky because he had a relationship somewhere and he got an easier time. But let's face it, in the major leagues, I didn't play well enough to stay. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't like, okay, well, could you be here long? Look, if I go there and stay there longer, I probably end up getting comfortable and starting to do well. But at the end of the day, you go there and, you know, you face guys that you may not have ever faced before. And the major leagues is the best of the best. So, yeah. And then in 97, I went to Asia, back to Taiwan for 3 years. I'd been in AAA for 5 straight years. And it was that thought process of, okay, well, I played in the major leagues. Now let's see if I can set up something for my family and go to Asia and make a little bit of money and buy a house and do that, because I've got X amount of years left. And
yeah,
I'm going to stay in AAA maybe for 3 or 4 more years. And, you know, but at the end of the day, I played the game for love, and it gave me so much throughout all those years. We got great years in Asia with my daughters, being exposed to, you know, those environments and seeing other parts of the world. So that was kind of a blessing as well. But yeah, at the end of the day, if you play better, you stay, right? And the one thing growing up, you know, your mind's a powerful tool. And my sense was to make the major leagues. Right. And then you make the major leagues. Well, that's what you said you wanted to do, and you made it. So you didn't say, I want to play for 10 years in the major leagues. So if there was anything that I would coach myself, if I could do it all over, would be have a mindset of to get there and play for 10 years. Right. Not, it was such a big hurdle for me to, you know, jump to get to the major leagues coming out of Cleveland, Ohio, with where things were not very well scouted. Back in those days. So it was pretty cool to have that opportunity.
No, I think that's good retrospect on your part. And obviously to be able to appreciate the years that were not in the bigs, like going over to Asia, and you know, you played in the now super popular stateside KBO because they had the ESPN TV deal last year. So that's something that's cool that you can look back on, and I'm sure you did it last summer when games were on TV. You're like, hey, that's I played there.
That was pretty neat to watch those games last year and see that that style of ball is still being played, and there's some really, really good players in other parts of the world, and it's good to see that.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Well, Ted, I've taken up a lot of your time. Could not be more appreciative. Great stuff. Great to have you recollect some of those memories for us. We're proud to have you as part of the USA Baseball family, and proud to have you, you know, actively engaged in the organization again, as you are now. So I'm fired up to have you around, and hopefully, you know, have you here for qualifying for the Olympics, and we can watch that. So that'll be good. But this was a lot of fun, Ted. I appreciate it, and we'll catch up again soon. Okay.
Thanks, Daron. Thanks for having me.
Really good stuff with Ted. My thanks to him. A solid guy who spent well over an hour with us there on this edition of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. A reminder again: rate and review wherever you listen to this podcast, whichever platform you use, and give USA Baseball a follow on social media at USA Baseball, pretty much whatever medium you use, even TikTok now. So that's fun. But until next time, I'm Daron Vaught. My thanks again to Ted Wood. We'll catch you later.